been presented traditionally in Francophone Africa, in France's colonies south of the Sahara. What I suppose I wanted to show was that the way in which that had often been portrayed in history books in France, but also in history books that were often used in Senegal as well, was that the impression you got from these history books was often that decolonization in French West Africa was a successful decolonization. And successful was, the word successful was used kind of to contrast between the French experience of decolonization in Indochina, which of course was a war of decolonization, and in Algeria, which again was a war of decolonization. And of course, compared to the experiences in Indochina and in Algeria, the process in French West Africa, as it then was relatively smooth. There was very little fighting. There was, as far as I'm aware, almost no loss of life. There were obviously a few episodes of conflict, particularly actually in Cameroon, where something like 80,000 people were probably killed. But in French West Africa, for the most part, it was a reasonably smooth transfer of power. And the history books portrayed this as a kind of product of a process of successful planning, that somehow France, the French leaders in the 1950s and early 1960s, and African leaders had got together and planned a relatively smooth process of decolonization. And as I read more and more of the archives, and as I interviewed people who had been actors in the process, it became increasingly clear to me that just wasn't true. It didn't happen like that. Nobody planned decolonization. Even up as late as 1958, and it's 2 years before independence, nobody was seriously envisaging independence, neither on the French side, nor for the most part. There were some exceptions to this, people, obviously like Secretary in Guinea. For the most part, this process had not been planned. Nobody was actually looking for independence. Very few, it's a very tiny minority that were looking for independence. What most of the actors were doing, both on the French side and the political leaders of what was about to become independent French West Africa, were looking for some kind of new relationship. They were looking to reconfigure the relationship. They were looking to maintain contacts, to maintain the links with the former colonial power. And all the, I read pages and pages and pages of documentation about the negotiations that took place between France and Senegalese, but also other political leaders from across French West Africa. And all of these negotiations were about, the word was always évolution. This is an evolving relationship. There was no sense of, you know, if you read the same sort of documents in the British archives, it's all about withdrawal, it's all about departure. Those words were never really mentioned. Nothing was about withdrawal and about departure. So it was about transferring, the French word that was used was le transfert du pouvoir, the transfer of powers. But as far as possible, the idea was that this was going to be a smooth process. So, in contrast to this notion of a planned process that the history books have put forward for many, many years, the abiding idea that I got from all the work that I was doing was that nobody planned it. It was almost, it was forced upon the key actors. It was only in 1959 that it was finally realised, I think, that independence was inevitable because of other countries, particularly in British Africa, were moving towards independence. There were a number of other international factors that were pushing towards independence, and I think de Gaulle realised that, you know, with the problems that France had in Indochina and Algeria, de Gaulle was very keen that France should not have a third war of decolonization. So there was suddenly a sort of change of heart at the end of 1959 that, oh, we're going to have to grant the former colonies, or the colonies, we're going to have to grant independence. And so the rapid process, almost at, as we would say in English, almost at the 11th hour, a rapid process of negotiation took place to try and organise, as far as possible, a smooth transition where the relationships would largely stay in place, although obviously the countries, former territories of French West Africa, would become independent. So partly what I do in the book is I try and unpick this process and to show how these continuities between the colonial period and the post-colonial period were put in place between French political leaders and African political leaders. The second thing that I was particularly aware of, and this is not so much in history, but certainly in journalistic coverage of the process of decolonization, was that a lot of the literature, both in France and in Africa, often presented France as having manipulated the whole process to ensure that it would remain as a significant presence in its former colonies. And there's a lot of literature about one of the most famous figures is somebody called Jacques Foccart, who was de Gaulle's right-hand man, his kind of éminence grise, his advisor on African affairs. And he's a very kind of shadowy figure. And so people have read into this that France was kind of manipulating behind the scenes, manipulating the process. And I suppose as I read through the archives and I talked to people, what I increasingly realised was that neither the French actors nor the African actors was in control of this process. Decolonization as a process had now developed a kind of momentum of its own. The United Nations was an important place where newly independent countries could voice their opposition to colonial rule. France was having increasing difficulties in Algeria. Britain was having its own difficulties in Kenya and other parts of its colonial empire. So there was a sense in which nobody was any longer controlling events. It was almost like they'd developed a momentum of their own. And what comes through when I read the archives and I talk to these people who were involved was that nobody felt that they could control what was going on. And so even people like Jacques Foccart, who is supposed to be the sort of, you know, shadowy figure in the shadows manipulating the process, that actually he was as lost by what was going on as pretty well everybody else. He was trying to figure out, he was trying to understand and advise de Gaulle, but often actually in practice getting it completely wrong. So that was what I tried to show. And the other part, which is less in the book, but which is also important, I think, in understanding the continuity from the colonial period to the post-colonial period, is the role of the military. Absolutely central to understanding why France is still such a major presence in parts of its former colonies. is the continuity of the French military presence, and the French military presence has no parallel with any of the other former colonial powers. If you look at Portugal, Belgium, Britain, no other former colonial power has maintained permanently placed troops, nor has intervened as much militarily in Africa as France has. So that was really what I was wanting to show in the book, and I've in fact just been asked to do a French translation of the book. So hopefully, sometime in the next year or so, a French translation of that book will be coming out. Now, just very briefly, because I'm aware that time is moving on, and I'd like you to have plenty of opportunity to ask questions. Just very briefly, since I wrote that book, which was 10 years ago now, I've been mainly working on French Africa policy and Franco-African relations in the contemporary period. So I've been particularly interested to try to understand how France's relationship with Africa has changed, particularly since 1993-1994. I think 1993-1994 is a key moment in understanding the changes in the relationship between France and Africa. Obviously, key things happened in 1993-94. There was the Rwanda genocide, in which France was considered by many to be complicit. There was the devaluation of the franc CFA. I remember it very well. I was here on the 12th of January 1994, and it was everybody who was making decisions about Africa policy. And I think the other thing that's changed is that African countries have a much larger range of partners that they can choose from than they had even just 10 years ago. And, I mean, I'm very aware, as I travel around West Africa, the increasing presence of China, but also India, Turkey, the Middle Eastern countries. African leaders now have a choice of partners, which probably, even just 5 or 6 years ago, they have a choice of partners that they probably didn't have 5 or 6 years ago. And so a medium-sized country such as France, such as the United Kingdom, have much more, much reduced capacity to influence what's happening in Africa than they did before. Because if the Senegalese government or the government of Mali or wherever it is doesn't like the conditionalities that the European Union or France or Britain is putting on aid monies or putting on partnerships, there's always the opportunity to go somewhere else. There are other countries, particularly what are called the emerging economies, as I say, like China and India, but also I've noticed the increasing presence of Brazil, for example, in some sectors in West Africa. So there's a range of partners, and I think the relationship has changed considerably over the last 10 to 15 years. I'm going to stop there, if anybody has any questions, I'll be happy to try to ask them. But that in 20 minutes, that's, if you like, a brief outline of my career and of my intellectual journey, if I can put it like that. Thank you for listening.
Oh, thank you very much for coming. So it's really a pleasure for me to be among you. So my question is, you were saying that a while ago, I mean, you are a professor of contemporary French study at the University of Portsmouth. So, I mean, my question is, what is the real, I mean, aim, the real impact for the student, I mean, for the England student to learn this kind of studies? And could you come back, I mean, for the relationship between French people and England people. Because yesterday I was watching, on France Vanguard, about the speech of François Hollande. And during his speech, he was talking about, his general politics. And, most of, news from England, particularly the Daily, related his kind of outing. And that was so funny. The reason why I'm asking, will you come back about this relationship between French people and English people? Thanks a lot.
Okay, I can take the first question. I'm not sure if I've understood the second question, so I might come back to you on that. But if I can take the first question, what difference does it make? I think it's very important that British students and French students understand the colonial past of their respective countries. One thing that I'm very struck by in French school curricula and university curricula, and in British school curricula and university curricula, is just how little the imperial past of those two countries, France and Britain, is studied. Which is extraordinary when you think that up until the Second World War, the two world superpowers were the UK and France. And that imperial past, in both cases, in the case of both France and Britain, went back two centuries. And yet, most British kids, French kids, most university students in France and Britain never study the colonial past of their respective countries. And I think that's absolutely essential, because both countries are now multicultural, largely as a result of that colonial past. The empire was for many, many years part of, very much an integral part of French and British national identity. If French and British national identity wasn't confined to the metropole, French and British national identity had this spatial dimension. It encompassed the empire. And I think understanding that past is really important. So I think what we can do in French studies at Portsmouth with the students who do the courses that we teach is we can, first of all, study the colonial past of France, but also, as part of that, invite students to think about Britain's colonial past and perhaps to compare the colonial experiences of the two countries, how in some ways they are similar and in some other ways profoundly different. And I think, and of course I would say this, wouldn't I, because I'm a historian, I think that understanding the present means understanding the past. It means understanding where we came from and how we got to where we are. So that would be my answer to your first question. I'm not quite sure that I understood fully your second question. It was about relations between France and the UK. Was that it? Yes. I think that's an interesting question. In some respects, France and the UK are obviously in competition with each other. Certainly, in the economic field, you often find French and British companies competing for markets. You will often find them pursuing very different agendas within the European Union. But on the other hand, France and Britain actually, in a way, have to work together. They are the only two members of the European Union who are permanent members of the UN Security Council. So you find increasingly, over the last 10 years, France and Britain working together at the level of the United Nations Security Council. And I think part of the reason for that, again, is that the emergence of the and the increasing assertiveness of Russia and China within the Security Council. So I think that Britain and France have to work together if they're going to continue to have influence on the world stage. I think also Britain and France are at best now medium-sized powers. They're not world powers in the way that they were. And they don't have the resources. Both countries have an economic crisis. They don't have the resources to do all the things that they used to do. So what you're finding, for example, is increasingly Britain and France, and this will be surprising to you perhaps, is the extent to which Britain and France are now cooperating on defence and military matters. Even to the extent of undertaking joint military missions and so on. And you also see that coming out in the way in which Britain and France, I mentioned it very briefly at the end of my presentation, Britain and France work together on African questions. Certainly in terms of the recent intervention in Mali, Britain's support for the French intervention in Mali was absolutely crucial to its rapid deployment. British resources, military resources, were made available within hours of the request coming from Paris. So, and I think that's the name of the game. That's the world in which we now live. It's a multipolar world, and smaller and medium-sized powers these days only have influence and leverage and importance if they can find ways to work together on issues that concern them.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chafer. I'm so happy and so captivated. I would say I'm so mesmerized by the broad lecture you have given us. These are questions you have satisfied, scratched my question all about these past 10 years. Because I was so interested in the relationship between the European countries and their colonies. And now I understand what I've learned from books through and the French version of what was going on in the past before the colonization. People made us believe that it was all planned. Now I understand it's a kind of natural process. And I would like to read a pretty much your book to have a further understanding. And referring to the question the guys asked, it's like, what's the impact of history in our everyday life? As you know now, today's globalization is occupying the space. And what's the impact of globalization? How will you know it? If you don't know history, how would you know how to answer the questions which are present, your present questions? And the relationship between the French and the Senegalese, well, I would say African governments, has a great impact. The colonization. If you consider the business, the output and input, the French people, they have interest in our, that's why our standard of living is getting higher and higher. Our life would be, you know, lower, the standard of living would be, the prices wouldn't be higher if we were not under, or we were not noted by the French government. Our CFA, our currency, has, people are questioning about our currency now, what is the future of the France, because France is not acting on their own personal, you know, will, because they are backed by the UA, the Economic Union. And this has profoundly changed the relationship between Africa and West African countries, French-speaking countries, because France is a kind of bridge between Europe and Africa. And you raised the question about Jafoka, which I watched a video, and now we have a modern Jafoka. I don't know whether you know about Bougie. Do you hear?
thank you very much, Guy. But I think that Africa today would be much more better without colonization or the presence of white people in our country. So I would just like to, you know, because I've noticed that also African countries, you know, went through a lot of ordeals throughout colonizations and slavery, and in European schools, all those things are glossed over. They hardly ever talk about colonizations or slavery. And don't you believe that it's about time that you, people like you, historians, you know, brought out this aspect, the sufferings, and also the contribution of Africa to World War I and II, where also African soldiers were sent to fight alongside European countries. Don't you think that it's good? It's the time that they also know that we have contributed to history. Because, you know, most of the time they say that Africa is not, has not got into history, not enough. But don't you believe that Africa has also contributed, even though it is just a little bit? And also they should also highlight our contribution, our fight. We were there on the front line. Don't you believe so? It is your duty as a historian to bring out those aspects. Thank you.
Yes, I completely agree, and I think that that the history of slavery and the history, as I indicated in my talk, the history of empire has been neglected. I think if you look back at the 20th century, perhaps the defining process of the 20th century, of the late 20th century, was the process of decolonization. It was the end of the European empires. And I think what sometimes happens when such major events as that take place is that there's almost a time period during which it's so painful that people kind of want to put it behind. And it takes a while before you can start to reflect on what happened, that historians start to work on and to try to understand what happened. And I think to some extent that's what happened with decolonization, particularly in the French case, because it was such a painful process with wars of decolonization in Indochina and then in Algeria. And I think it was really, the end of the 1990s, beginning of the 2000s, that you really began to see historians working on and trying to understand. And I agree with you, that historians do have a duty to try to understand and to explain these processes. And I'd like to think that in my own very small, modest way, that I've contributed to that process. But I think in a sense that it's almost that period has to pass before it's possible then to start this process of historical analysis and understanding. But of course, that process of analysis and understanding, it then takes a long time for that to feed into the school programs and the university curricula and so on. And it's only really just beginning in Britain. And I think in France, it still hasn't begun, to be honest. I mean, we have French students who come to study in our university in Portsmouth. We have French students, and they choose to come and study French decolonization with me. And they will often say to me at the end of their semester program with me, "We never ever study any of this in France." So the work of historians over the last 10 years hasn't yet fed through into into the school curricula. It hasn't yet fed through into the wider examinations for secondary schools, to the or even in many cases to university curricula. Slavery is an interesting one, I think. That's a huge area of expanded interest in the United States. And particularly, I think that the United States, American historians over the last 20 years have become very interested in the sort of American role and the American past. And African American historians particularly have been very interested in the history of slavery within the United States. And even there, that's really only in the last 5 to 10 years that historians have begun to become interested in the African dimension of that. The focus among American historians of slavery has been very much about understanding slavery in the United States. The last 5 years have begun to see some very interesting work, I think, on how this slave trade impacted on Africa and the role of Africans within it. And that's been taken up by some historians at UCAD who are now working on that area as well. So perhaps in another 10 years' time, that will begin to have its impact on school and university curricula. But it's very much a work in progress, I think.
Short questions.
I'll try
and
do short answers.
So good afternoon, Mr. Chafer. So my name is Mohammed, and it's a pleasure meeting you. So my question turns around partnership. Upon knowing Senegal is a French-speaking country, so what type of interaction can both Senegal and Britain have in terms of studying, policy, or cooperation?
Did you say what type of relation?
Interaction.
Shall we repeat the questions?
Professor Chafer, I have two questions. The first question is, why did you specialize in West Africa civilization, and which issue have you find managing both European and African culture? The second question is, according to your explanation, I want to know if your book is elitism of African leader and European leader about their lack of responsibility.
Good afternoon, Professor Tony. So I am so glad to your outstanding lecture you delivered, as a young researcher specialized in African studies. It is a great opportunity, right? Now, before asking the question, I would like first to have some information regarding the book you have released. So, because as African, so young African research, sometimes we have problems to be in touch, to get in touch with books related to African studies, right? And I will be right by the hand of this class to be the first to, right, to have access to this, this book. Now, regarding my question, it is based on the relationship between French and Senegal or African countries, because as you know, now we are aware that French is no longer he used to be. It's time for France to be aware that, right, economically speaking, it's not the, the leader in the world.
I'll try to answer these questions. The first one was about what kind of interaction can the UK and Senegal have. And I think that's an important question. Senegal is one of the few countries, francophone countries, in which Britain actually has an embassy. And Britain has very, very few embassies in French-speaking countries in Africa. And I think in many ways, the if you like, the old historical links remain in place. You know, Britain still has its, insofar as it still has links, it tends to have links in West Africa with Ghana and Sierra Leone and Nigeria, and much less with the French-speaking countries. So, and of course, Britain knows its former colonies much better than it knows the French-speaking colonies. As I say, I'm one of only two people in UK higher education working on French-speaking Africa. There's me at Portsmouth and there's Gordon Cumming at Cardiff. That's it. So I think part of the problem in terms of developing interactions is resources. I think that insofar as both France and Britain are no longer major powers, they no longer have the resources to be present everywhere. I think what's tending to happen is, in the context of the economic crisis that we're all suffering from, France is tending to focus its efforts in the areas of the world which it knows best, and Britain is tending to focus its efforts in the areas that it knows best. Where can there be interactions? Well, I think where there can be interactions is the level of the English language. I think one thing that strikes me, I mean, I've been coming to French-speaking Africa for nearly 30 years now. When I first started coming here, nobody spoke English. Now, lots of people speak English. And so I think the language opens up opportunities. I think it opens up opportunities for interactions which weren't there before. I'm not sure that I understood the second question.
Could you repeat your question?
Could you just repeat
your question?
Ah, yes, okay.
The first question is, why did you specialize in West Africa civilization? And which issue do you find managing both European and African culture?
Okay, so the first one was, why did I specialize in... I think probably two reasons. One's professional, one's personal.
Exactly.
The professional reason was that France's presence in Africa was concentrated in Western Central Africa. And so, given that I was working in a French department, there was a professional reason for focusing on and developing an interest in the parts of Africa where French was spoken. So I think there was that. And also, as a historian, there are very few historians of Africa in the UK who speak French. So historians in the UK or in the United States who work on Africa tend to work on Anglophone Africa because they can access the materials, they can access the archives, they can talk to people. There are very, very few African historians who can speak French and therefore can access the material. So I think the language is a barrier. What did I find particularly? What did I find particularly to focus on? I suppose because I'm particularly a historian of politics. I suppose the different political cultures in French-speaking Africa and English-speaking Africa was of great interest to me. I think you can understand a lot about political systems in a country such as Benin or Senegal, by looking to the French Republican tradition, the way in which constitutions were written. I think you can understand a lot about that, and I think you can understand a lot about political systems in the former British colonies by looking at the British parliamentary system and looking at how aspects of that were taken. So I think the sort of comparative political dimension is one of the ones that's most interested me. The third question was about the book. Well, the book is... I'll try and answer the third question. If there's anything I've missed, come back to me in a minute. About the book, well, the book is only in English at the moment. I've now had it translated into French, and I'm in the process of editing the translation, and then it'll take about a year for it to come out. So hopefully it will be published in about 16 months' time by the press. So, and the other question, finally, was about France losing its power, and is it time for France to move away, I think was the term that was used. I think that's happening. I think it's happening anyway. I think it's part of the move away from France having a special, exclusive relationship with its former colonies in Africa, and now it is part of a series of partnerships between former French colonies and the rest of the world. So Senegal now has relations with China, with India, with the Middle Eastern countries, with Turkey, with Brazil. And so I think it's part of the, I think there's a natural process going on. The other thing I would say, when I sense under the sort of time for France to go away, as if it's, as if there's a feeling that France is still somehow imposing its will in its former colonies. And I think, I mean, one of the things that strikes me when I do interviews in Paris is how French officials and politicians feel that they can no longer influence things in Africa, that it's actually very difficult to influence things in Africa, and even though they will work with their European partners. You have to remember that the European Union is 27, now 28 nations, 24 of whom, and I'm caricaturing here, but 24 of whom broadly have no interest in Africa at all. They have no past. They have no particular interest in Africa. You think of countries like Estonia, Lithuania, Latvia, Bulgaria, Romania. Most of these countries have no interest in Africa at all, and they don't understand why France, Belgium, the UK, and Portugal in particular are promoting links between the EU and Africa, why Europe should be interested in Africa. So I think there's a kind of process going on of diversification of relationships, and I think it's happening anyway as part of a wider process of globalization. Yes, and I think that one of the things that struck me as I read histories of decolonization was that you often felt that they were read by people who were looking at what happened from the point of view of the Europeans. And that's what you'd expect. European historians writing from a European perspective about the decolonization process. And I suppose what I, one of the things that I'm very aware of is that this is a process which was not a one-way process. It wasn't France dictating what was happening. It wasn't Britain dictating what was happening. There was a process of negotiation, interchange, conflict, and African politicians and political leaders and French and British political leaders were very much part of that process and had a responsibility in that process. So I don't think, as a historian, I'm not interested in kind of allocating responsibility. I'm not interested in allocating blame. But what I am interested in doing is trying to understand how this complex relationship, in which nobody really actually understood what was going on, nobody was really in control of events, how the process played out in the way that it did. And that, I think that was what was of interest to me particularly.
Well, my name is Ibrahimo. And my question, I really want to know, like you know, do you came across of any problem or any difficulties in your life or in your career?
Any difficulties? Well, yes, I can think of many.
Of course.
I think one of the greatest difficulties actually was convincing colleagues that we ought to be studying Africa. I think that the great majority of my colleagues, when I began to work on what used to be France's colonies in Africa, when I started to work on Afrique francophone, I think one of the most difficult things I had was actually convincing other colleagues that this was a good idea. Why do we need to study Africa? What is the, within a French studies program, what's the interest in studying Africa? And I think that from their perspective, and I can understand it, from their perspective, I think there was almost complete ignorance of France's role in Africa. You go back 30 years and it was almost completely a blank page. And it took a few years to actually convince colleagues that actually, if you're going to understand modern France, and if you're going to understand the French-speaking world, that the largest number of countries where French is the official language is actually in Africa. There are actually more French speakers outside France, and particularly in Africa, than there are inside France. And that actually, if we're going to have a degree in French studies, we have to understand France in this wider context, and particularly France's complex and long-standing relationship with Africa. So I think that was probably one of my most, that was one of my greatest difficulties. The other one, which was related to it, and the fact that Matthew and Julia are here is testimony to the fact that I won this battle, was actually convincing colleagues that we should send students to Africa as part of what was then an exchange program, that we should be sending students to Africa, that they should have the possibility of studying and working in Africa as part of their program of study, rather than just going to France or Belgium. And for two or three years, colleagues were quite clear that students who were studying French would go to France. It took, as I remember, about 3 years before it was eventually agreed that we could start to send students to Senegal, and I'm proud to say that for 23 years now, every year we have been sending students to Senegal who have been able to discover more about this wonderful country in the way that I have.
How do you see the France-Africa in the time of Boko Yobani in comparison with now?
Okay. One of the things that I think is interesting about that term "false Afrique," which I actually try not to use too much. And one of the things that's interesting is that the term false athlete was actually coined, it was actually invented by Houphouët-Boigny. And he invented it, I think, in 1963. And he saw it as an expression that gave expression to what he wanted to remain as a special relationship between France and Francophone Africa. So for him, false athlete, when he coined the term in 1963, was very much a positive term. It was what he aspired to as a political leader, to maintain a special privileged relationship between France and Francophone Africa. Now, of course, that term, false athlete, resurfaced in the 1990s, particularly in the work of somebody who you may have come across, François-Xavier Verschave. And false athlete became a shorthand for everything that was corrupt and wrong about France's relationship with Africa. So when it resurfaced 30 years later, it had exactly the opposite meaning to what it had when Houphouët-Boigny created the term. So what's different? Well, I think what's different, it's really just going back to the things I've been saying, is that I think that the relationship between France and its former colonies in Africa has changed. It's changed fundamentally. It's a relationship that France is no longer, as I've tried to show in my book, it's a relationship that even at the time of decolonization, France wasn't in control of. And I suppose one way of looking at the history of the last 50 years is of France gradually losing that special relationship, that exclusivity of the relationship. France, Senegal, as for most of Francophone African countries, France is one partner among many. It's certainly no longer an exclusive partner.
If you're today, my question is not too long, but I think it's very important. So what kind of advice are you going to give to students here who are going to further their higher studies in Britain?
In Britain. Okay.
What I have to say in response to that question is that we have a government that's actually making it increasingly difficult for students from outside the European Union to come and study in Britain. We have a government that has as a centerpiece of its policy to reduce immigration from outside the European Union. Now, I think every university in the UK has been lobbying the government to say students are not immigrants, students want to come and study. But the government continues to regard students who want to come to study in the UK from outside the European Union as immigrants. And the result is that it's become increasingly difficult to get a visa to study. I mean, it's not just the case in the UK, it's other European countries as well, but we have a government that is particularly following a very, very hard line. And I think it's a policy that's wrong. I think it's a policy that's short-sighted. I think it's a policy that's not in the interests of anybody. I don't think it's in the interest of the UK. I don't think it's in the interest of anybody. But I'm just one voice. And my university and every other university has taken up with the government how short-sighted this policy is, but I'm afraid while we have the government that we have at the moment, it's a debate, it's an argument, it's a campaign that we're not going to win. And I'm ashamed to say that it will continue to be difficult for students from outside the European Union to come and study in the UK.
To highlight more or to clarify, I would like to thank you, you know, for your brilliant presentation, you know. Maybe we'll have the opportunity, you know, to get in touch with your book. Okay, my question tackle with the British policy compared to France. You know, I think in Britain they don't have, you know, public university, different from France. I mean, you know, the middle class or the lower, the poor, I think, you know, it will be very difficult or hard, you know, for them to be high educated, I mean, in the university. My question is how the government has set such a policy different from France, you know, maybe, you know, this high education will be limited only, you know, for the rich, if I may say, you know, if I don't exaggerate. Thank you.
Yes, I mean, the UK now has the highest fees in the world, I think, apart from the United States, for the highest registration fees. And that is the fear, is that it will become increasingly difficult from anybody from middle class, lower middle class, lower class backgrounds, less well-off backgrounds, to study in higher education. The government would respond, yes, well, we've put in place grants and a range of support so that students from less well-off backgrounds can still continue to study at university. But the fact remains that if you want to study at a British university now, you do have to take on a lot of debt in order to be able to do it. France has maintained a public education system with much lower fees. And I think that's a good thing. I think the problem is that the French universities are often short of money. They're starved of money. There isn't enough money to invest in French universities, precisely because the registration fees are too low. So it's almost like France and Britain are at two ends of a spectrum. Over here is France with a public system with very low fees, and over here is the UK with a privatised system and very high fees. And I think probably the best system will be somewhere in the middle, neither the French nor the British system.
Globalization. It's like this. We talk about globalization. Okay. Do you think that Africa is concerned by this globalization? Because in Africa, we have more troubles than solutions. And the love of power overcomes the power of love. Even for being united, it is a big deal. So, if we talk about globalization, we think that Africa is concerned about this. Thank you.
I think in a sense we're all concerned by globalization. It impacts on all of us. I suppose the first thing I would say, though, is it depends what you understand by globalization, because there are, to me, there are at least two different dimensions of it. There's, if you like, the cultural globalization, which is often simply another word for Americanization or Hollywoodization. It's the spread of the English language and of aspects of American culture and their march, it seems, inexorable march across the whole world. And I see that happening in Africa as much as I see it elsewhere. I mean, the same Hollywood blockbusters, the same the same interest in the YouTube videos and the
you know, there is a whole sort of cultural process of globalization which we're all part of. If we're connected to the internet, if we watch television, if we watch films and so on and so forth. But there's a more serious part, which is the economic globalization. And I think that what's happening at the moment presents an enormous opportunity for Africa as a continent. It's the fastest growing part of the world in terms of economic growth. It has huge resources. It has huge resources in terms of raw materials. It has huge resources in terms of precious metals. It has huge potential. And I think the challenge for everybody, for Africa, for those living in Africa, but for those outside, is to ensure that the benefits of the exploitation of those resources are spread to the population as a whole. My fear is that the resource boom, if you like, the exploitation of these resources, whether it's oil, whether it's copper, whether it's uranium, whatever it is that it's only a small elite who benefit from the exploitation of those resources. And I think the enormous challenge that we all have is to ensure that the benefits of those resources are spread as widely as possible to the people of Africa.
Can you hear me?
Yes. Again? Louder?
As a professor, what kind of talk would you have with somebody who wanted to teach like you? So I'm looking for advice.
I suppose my first piece of advice, would be persistent. If you know it's what you want to do, I think you just need to hold on to that and to pursue it for as far and for as long as you can, because certainly, if I think back when I was setting out, it was extraordinarily difficult to get started. And I think getting the necessary qualifications and then finding the necessary, finding the opportunities was a real challenge. So I suppose my first piece of advice would be, if it's really what you want to do, believe in yourself and stick with it and persist with it.
He's not here today because he's at the Gamo, so it's a question from Abdul Tambadu. And he would like to ask you, with the rise of the internet these days, and we can learn so much online, will there be a need for teachers, and especially language teachers, in the future, or do you think we will learn everything online? The question is to do with a debating competition that we have a representative from Boris from Benin. He's a representative for a competition called The Great Speaker, which is a debating contest. And in your life, you have written theses and dissertations, and you have had to defend these pieces of work. So, for the benefit of all of us, I would like to know how you go about defending an academic piece of work, how you make yourself persuasive, how you make yourself understood, and how you prove a point in an academic way. What is the process?
Well, the first question was about the internet and online teaching, and will we in future need buildings, I suppose?
Exactly.
Will we be able to do it all online through video streaming and so on? And certainly I think that's going to be increasingly important. There are more and more courses that are now delivered by what is called distance learning. So you can be anywhere in the world to follow those courses. And I think particularly for people who are working already, that is important, because often, you know, you might be working in, I don't know, you might be working in Qatar, or you might be working in India or Pakistan, but what you want to study is only available in Canada or the UK. You can't then fly to Canada or the UK and take 2 years out from working in order to get that qualification. So I think increasingly people will be, as part of their professional careers, if you like, as part of their professional development, will be doing courses that are online, that are not necessarily where you have to go to a building or a place and study. And in many cases, you may never go to that place to study. I know, for example, at my own university in Portsmouth, we have a master's course in translation studies. On that master's course in translation studies, and a lot of professional translators do the course, we have 12 students actually at Portsmouth doing the course, a campus-based course. We have 120 students registered to do that course for distance learning, and there are 120 students around the world. And so I think that's going to happen more and more, particularly, as I say, for people's professional development when they're in a job and they want to improve their professional knowledge or perhaps change their career direction. I think that's the sort of thing that we will see all universities doing more and more of. Whether it will replace, I don't think so. I think that I think people still like to talk to people. I think people still like to interact with each other, like we're doing today. I think, and you mentioned languages in particular, I think actually languages is something where the face-to-face interaction is really, really important. You can't simply, you know, learn the pronunciation, learn the words out of any kind of context. And so I think that that face-to-face interaction is important. And I think people will continue to want it, at least for doing their first degree or their first qualification. I think people enjoy and benefit from the direct face-to-face interaction. The second question, debating contest and how you defend pieces of work. Well, I suppose there's two things I would say. One is be very, very, very well prepared. Read around the subject so that you've got a good knowledge, not simply of what you want to say, but of the context of the subject, so that you have a broad understanding of the topic. And out of that reading, choose well-considered examples to support the arguments that you want to put over. So I suppose that would be my first piece of advice, is make sure you're well-prepared, well-read, and have got a good in-depth knowledge. The second thing I would say is always think carefully about the difficult questions that people are going to ask you. So if I'm preparing a debate, for example, the first thing I'll do is I'll think about the things I want to say, and then think about what somebody else is going to want to ask me to try and prove that I'm wrong. So always think about the counter opinions, the questions that people are going to ask you in an attempt to trip you up, in an attempt to find a problem, find a gap, find something that's missing, something that's wrong with your argument. So what I do often is I actually get people, when I've written something or when I've written some initial ideas, I actually get people who I know well, but who often disagree with me. and I get them to look at what I've actually written and get them to critique it. And I find that process very, very helpful because it forces me to think about what it is I'm saying and whether or not I've got the answers to the objections, the answers to the criticisms. And so I'd really strongly advise to do that. Always try your ideas out on a number of people, particularly people who you know are going to be critical, rather than people who are going to say, oh yes, I agree with you, I agree with you, oh yes, absolutely. What you want is you want people who are not going to agree with you to try and challenge what you're saying, and that will help you to strengthen the arguments that you're going to make.
So, thank you so much. Oh, we still have more questions, I think.
No, I have one more.
We have one more?
Yes.
All right, the bonus had one first. Okay, there you go, take that. Okay. Okay. Last question.
From Obama.
Obama.
Yeah. It's Obama, but not the real Obama.
All right. Okay.
Yeah, but
after you cross
the
curtain, what's your question now? As a professor, you are supposed to have many students with different behaviors. Sometimes they make you happy and sometimes they make you unhappy. So my question is, what is your best moment and your worst moment in your job?
That's an international question. The best moment and your worst moment in your job.
And the worst
best
moment in your job.
Right, I suppose the best moment for me, I mean, obviously, I do a lot of research and I do a lot of other things, but I suppose I still regard myself first and foremost as a teacher. And so the best moment of my job is when the students who I've been teaching do very well, when they get very good marks and when they get a very good qualification at the end of their program of study. I get a great deal of satisfaction and happiness out of seeing students do well and succeed. And also, I often keep in touch with former students. I also get a great deal of pleasure out of seeing what students who I used to teach have gone on to do, and the interesting and challenging things that they go on to do. So I suppose the best moment is seeing students succeed. The most difficult moment, it's difficult to answer that, what the most difficult moment is. I suppose at one level, the most difficult moment is perhaps the other side of the coin. It's seeing students who really struggle. It's seeing students who, at the end of the day, don't make it, who fail, and who drop out, and have to leave. And in some cases, you know it's that they probably haven't done enough work. But in some cases, they're students who have tried, but just didn't get there in the end. And despite the support you were able to give them, they just weren't able to make it. So I think probably those are the two. They're the on the one hand, the good moments when students who you've taught do well, and the bad moments are the ones who, despite your best efforts, didn't quite make it.